Welcome to Sherwood Park United Church, and a special welcome to those of you joining us on YouTube this morning. We're so happy to have you with us. Now, God be with you.
And also with you.
Are there any announcements?
Okay. I'm just reminding people that over July, August, and September, we're having different people sign out crossing the river. It tells the story of Sandra Hays Gardner experience looking at how she would like to create reconciliation, and it through her process it kind of invites you to figure that out for yourself in the community. So we have almost 10 people who have already read it, so we hope that others of you will join in. Thank you.
Good morning. I am Lorraine Kraus, the MNP liaison to the leadership team. This will be a brief update from our June the 26th meeting. We welcome Dale Dawson to our leadership team and appreciate that she has agreed to join us. Thank you, Dale. This month we had a very abbreviated agenda, which allowed us time to do some in-depth work on three upcoming events. I'll talk to you about them in the order in which they are occurring. So we start off on July the 17th with a collaborative workshop. This is the title for a get-together being held on Wednesday the 17th, meeting with the Council of Salisbury United Church and our leadership team. We're looking at ways that our two communities of faith can work together for the betterment of our entire community. The event will be facilitated by past moderator Jordan Cantwell. Jordan is currently the growth animator for the Prairie region of the United Church. During our meeting with the leadership team, together with Stuart Jackson, Debbie Stiles, and Bruce West, we were given a questionnaire by Jordan. We came up with a consensus of answers from our community of faith, and these, together with Salisbury's answers, will be given to Jordan to help her facilitate this workshop. I'd like to add to those folks who go to yoga, we'll be welcomed at Salisbury United Church on that session morning. The second event is How's It Going 3.0, Connecting the Dots. And you've heard Ann McMeekin, Sheila Klein, and Corrine Wiseman talk about this event. This is a workshop, a third in the series, sponsored by the United Churches in the area. And it will be hosted by Marianne Pastuck. No, it won't be hosted her. She'll be facilitating it. We'll be hosting it here at Sherwood Park United Church. They have been very successful in planning what sounds like a very interesting event, and they were received a grant from Northern Spirit to defray those costs. The governance model is our work in progress. Wayne Flewelling, Ann McMeekin, Ruth West, and Kathy Jackson have been diligently working on this. The draft was reviewed in detail by all leadership team members. Some minor changes were made, and another draft will be prepared. We intend to have the final draft for everyone to review prior to a tea talk, which is planned for November the 3rd. This will be an opportunity for all the community to discuss. The goal at that point will be to have a completed document ready for the AGM in 2025. Our next leadership meeting is August the 28th at 1 p.m. Attached to this week's newsletter, and I have two copies here, are the goal-setting retreat facilitated by and prepared by Larry Durkash. We hope this will be attached to the newsletter. Did I say that? We hope you'll be able to pursue it and pass along your comments. Thank you.
Okay, so that's the announcements. That was short. I just wanted to announce this morning that our upcoming summer theme for this summer is going to be kindness. Every summer I break with the lectionary and work on something maybe a little bit different, and which usually has one theme. Last summer we talked about the saints of summer, and this summer we are going to be looking into scripture about what does scripture say about kindness. What does it mean and what is it about? So you can look forward to that. I know I am. I won't see you all next Sunday. My daughter is flying in from China sometime today. We're not exactly sure when. She got stuck in an airport and there's a storm there. So she's going to be probably not in until sometime tonight. So we haven't seen her since before COVID. So this is a big time for our family. Let us pray. Oh Lord God, we thank you that you are here and you're in this place this morning. We thank you for this celebration of love after 30 years. We thank you that you are with those who are ill, those who are in hospital, those who are healing, for those going through chemotherapy, for those with mental health challenges, those who have upcoming surgery, for their caregivers, and for those who love them, for their worries and their concerns. We pray that you would give them peace. We pray that our hearts would be filled with your calm. In this day, as many others going forward, we pray also that you would be with us as we chart our course for this church in 2024. We thank you that tomorrow is the birthday of this great country. We thank you that we are a part of it. We thank you for creating it. We thank you for the love that we are able to share as a family. In your precious name we do pray. Amen. 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 We will now have the passing of the peace in whatever way is comfortable for you. Peace be with you.
I would like to give a personal land acknowledgement. As a seventh generation European settler, about a piece of land that is very dear to my husband Bruce and me. It is located on Elizabeth Island near Parry Sound, Ontario, on the eastern shores of Georgian Bay, a part of Lake Huron. It was purchased in 1972 by my parents, and my family and I have enjoyed summers there at our cottage ever since. The beautiful eastern Georgian Bay area is a UNESCO World Biosphere region, as is the Beaver Hills area here in Alberta. Its forests are filled with oaks, white pine, and maple trees. It sits on the solid rock of the Canadian Shield, and its crystal clear waters are found off its sandy beaches. And in the midst of all this beauty, there are many, many cottages. This area is called cottage country for a reason. So, today I want to acknowledge that the cottage that my family enjoys every summer on Elizabeth Island, on the eastern shores of Georgian Bay, a part of Lake Huron, is in the territory of the Robinson-Huron Treaty, signed in 1850. This treaty includes the Indigenous people and the settlers who live on the shores of Lake Huron and the northern shores of Lake Superior. My family has enjoyed many summers at our Elizabeth Island cottage and want to thank the generations of Indigenous people who have taken care of that land and its waters for thousands of years. We love our spot and all that we can do there. Canoe on its waters, watch sunsets from its beach, pick blueberries in its woods, just as the Indigenous people did before us. But for all these summers, I have given no thought to the Robinson-Huron Treaty or the hardships and the poverty endured by the Indigenous people there because of treaty promises and treaty agreements that were not kept. Notably, compensation to the Indigenous people for minerals mined in the area. I commit myself to being aware of what is being done now by the provincial and federal governments to finally honor those agreements and compensate the Indigenous people fairly. And I commit our family to being good stewards of the land, air and water of the eastern Georgian Bay, as the Indigenous peoples did before us and continue doing today. Miigwech. Thank you.
Beautiful, Edmund. Thank you. We will now have the lighting of the Christ candle. This week's word comes from 1 Peter 2:9. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of God who called you out of the darkness into God's wonderful light. Amen. Thank you, Diane. All right. This is the final Sunday of Pride Month. Please join me in the call to worship. Come to this place where we belong, a place of welcome and of witness.
We come to rejoice in the one who celebrates each and all of us.
Rejoice again and again, for this is our place. We are invited by the risen Christ.
We come to the ark in thanksgiving for such an unconditional love.
Here we discover whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, whatever calls us to excellence.
We come to seek word and imagination, our place at our table.
We come to praise God in song and now in prayer. Please stand as you are able. God of welcome, God of love, we come as you invite us to travel your way.
Here we enroll into your heart and into ours, in the symphony of your creation. You call us to rejoice in the harmonies, to encounter nature and honor peace, and everything in between, as a gift of diversity,
to take the rest as they come. To sustain the notes of joy for each other. We praise you for inviting everyone to be born into new life, belonging to you. Amen.
Let us take a moment to pray for illumination. O Lord, we wait for you, and in your word we trust. By the power of your Spirit, Set our hearts and minds on the source of life and peace, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Okay. Today's readings begin with the psalm lesson, and it has a sung refrain. It's kind of echoey. That goes like this. I'd love to say that, then sing it, but we'll follow the script. God is my shepherd, nothing I shall lack. You, God, make me lie down in green pastures. You lead me beside peaceful waters. You revive my spirit. You guide me in right pathways for your name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you are with me. Your rod and your staff are my comfort. You spread a table for me in the sight of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup is overflowing. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the God's house Our second lesson is from the New Testament, reading from the second letter to the Corinthians in chapter 8. Since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. I am not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And here is my judgment about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now finish the work so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. The goal is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. Amen.
Thank you, Kathy. When I was in hospital, I spent a certain amount of time rallying against what had happened to me and my discontent often voiced itself in my head because I couldn't do it to the nurses or doctors because they're helping me, plus one of my children is a nurse, so that just didn't feel right. And one of the things that I remember saying to myself is, I don't belong here. I just don't. I don't belong here. I shouldn't be here. But I was. And the idea of belonging and how important that is started to seep through this wooden thing that I call a head. And I started to think about belonging in all the different ways that we belong to things and how important it is to us to have that sense of belonging and love. And there is a wonder in belonging. There just is. So I've entitled this piece, Blessed to be a Blessing. For belonging can mean a lot of different things. For we belong to a church, Sherwood Park United. We belong to this wonderful country of Canada. Amen. Perhaps we belong to a club where we play golf or we go swimming or we do exercise. Perhaps we belong to the choir or to a family. Belonging brings with it rights and privileges. But Paul reminds us of something here. It also brings with it responsibilities. My brother Harold, he gave me a pillow, which was embroidered with the words, I smile because you are my sister. Now, isn't that sweet? And then underneath it, it says, I laugh because there's nothing you can do about it. That's my brother, okay? This is the man, the oldest in the family. And so part of my responsibility there was obviously to take that pillow and hit him over the head with it, which I did. I love my brother. He's a great guy. 2 Corinthians 8 could easily be turned into a kind of Ann Landers advice column with a spiritual flavor. As the apostle spends much of this passage encouraging the reader to excel in the grace of giving. Here Paul grounds his call to the believer's generosity in the startling generosity of God in Jesus Christ. When Paul states that you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, Paul doesn't claim Corinth's Corinthians simply know about the Lord Jesus Christ and his grace. He reminds them that they know that grace, implying that the Christians in the Corinthian church have not just heard about God's grace, but they have experienced it. God's grace is in our very being. It's a part of us. It's in our mind. It's in our heart. It's in our blood. It's in our bone. It is the grace that holds it all together. That grace, the apostle continues, manifested itself in the way that for your sake, through Christ, though Christ was rich, he became poor. Our Lord Jesus Christ traded all the glory that he enjoyed in the heavenly realm for the reality of the life of an itinerant rabbi and the death of a common criminal. New Testament scholar James Lancaster Peterson sees this impoverishment clearly in Jesus' crucifixion. The cross, she writes, represents a total emptying out of the riches of Jesus' position as God's beloved. Jesus did all that and more so that we, through Christ's poverty, might become rich. While we may be tempted to think of wealth as a material possession, that's certainly not what the apostle has in mind here. The riches which the apostle refers to here almost certainly include God's grace, the grace that we've received with our faith, but it also includes our possession of eternal life, our status as God's children, and even the opportunity to share our material resources with those who have fewer of them than we have. For Christ gave up everything for the Corinthians' sake. This is extraordinary in light of the contentious nature of Corinth's Corinthians, to whom the apostles feel compelled not to send just one letter, but two, in which Paul and Timothy insist that Christ gave up everything so that we might have everything. Just think of it. With the Spirit's help, we can excel in the grace of giving. After all, God first excelled in the grace of giving to us. Our willingness to give generously is fueled by God's willingness to give so generously to us. The plenty that frees us to supply what our fellow Christians need is modeled on the plenty that God uses to meet all of our needs, and so often more than that, not only our needs, but our wants too. We give generously because God so generously first gave to us. This reminds me of 1 John 4:19. It says, we love because he first loved us. Love made the first move. God also made the first move in giving. Paul observes that last year you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. They weren't just the first Christians to give generously. The Christians in Corinth were also the first to want to give in that way. Attitude matters. How we feel about why we are giving, it matters. However, Paul doesn't expect Corinth's Christians' generosity to impoverish them. The poverty of others doesn't require that we give more than we can afford. What matters is that our willingness to share generously is present, no matter the size of the gift. Paul states that our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. They can be generous because they're part of the mutually supportive body of Christ. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, writes the apostle, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. Then there will be equality. The central appeal in this piece is to follow the example of Christ. But other requests are included, such as, let this gracious work match your other spiritual gifts and prove how sincere your love for us is. Also, finish what you have started and give as much as you can afford. And in Christ's spirit, share your resources with Christians less fortunate. Leave it to Paul to keep it practical. With the opening word, but, Paul turns from the good example of the Macedonians and the news that Titus is returning to a direct appeal to the Corinthians, for they are a gifted church. They abound in so many things. Their faith is genuine. Their earnestness and diligence has never been in question. Their gifts of speaking and of knowledge are praised. And their renewed loyalty shows their love for Paul. Through Christ They have been enriched in every way. Does that sound familiar? Even this gracious work of receiving the collection, of receiving the offering, indicates that when done, it will be God who does it. Yet in will and deed, the believers are called to play their active part. Paul encourages them to do it generously, to abound in this work of grace also. Paul urges rather than commands, for a good deed is always willingly done. And the Corinthians make the decision for themselves, as do we all. This passage is firmly anchored in the generous self-giving of our Lord Jesus Christ, a story which is now ours, a story to which we too now belong, and it belongs to us, a story which overcomes boundaries and broadens our view of what is possible, the story of light coming into the darkness, the light we follow on our own journey of discovery. I wonder then, how will the Spirit ask us today to make use of our time, our talents, our resources? And how, my friends, will we answer? Amen. Amen.
331.
With God, the three in one, and shall suffer communion with those whom rest is won. Oh, happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them, the meek and lowly, on high shall dwell with thee.
Let us say together the prayers of the people. As we gather here with God's presence in the midst of us, let us pray. We bring to you, Lord, the church in all its richness and all its need, all its diversity, and all of its division.
Give us a fresh understanding of what it means to live in you. May we celebrate the reality of your presence among us, filling us with new life
and new hope. Thank you, O God, that you've taken this time to be with us. Thank you for the hope that you bring. Jesus Christ, Lord, in your presence, we bring to you, Lord, our nation, our world, our universe.
All the areas that are fast and shut,
I want you out. All the bewildered confusion about who we are and why we are here. All the doubts and insecurity and all the searching for inner peace. Lord, in your presence, we bring to you, Lord, our homes and families and all the joys and sorrows of our relationships. Lord, in your presence, we bring to you, Lord, those whom life has damaged and all who find it difficult to trust in you. We bring to you, Lord, the love of our hearts for us, which understands our frailty. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of Jesus on page 916, a translation. Our Father, Mother, who is in the heavens, may your name be made holy. May your dominion come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the bread we need, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And do not put us to the test, but rescue us from evil. For yours is the dominion and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. I thought that since tomorrow is Canada Day, it might be kind of appropriate to sing O Canada. So as you are able, let us join together in our closing hymn, O Canada.
Oh,
Amen. Therefore, in remembrance of the mighty acts and blessed promises of Jesus, we offer ourselves to God as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Let us know your Holy Spirit upon us, gathered here out of love for you, as we go into the world in strength and unity. Amen.